All the plugins. First of all, I want to tell everybody that if you have questions while I'm going through this talk, raise your hand. Go right to the mic, raise your hand, somebody will bring you a mic. The point of this is to provide you with the information that you guys are looking for and not what I feel like dictating. The second point to make is this is not an advanced talk. I know it says intro, but I just want to make sure everybody knows that you're not going to learn about abstract classes or interfaces here. We're going to cover the basics, which is actually what you need the most for successfully integrating with plugins like WooCommerce or GravityForms, or really any plugin that's taken the time to document its number of hooks and places where you can integrate with. So, with all that said, let's go ahead and jump in. The most important thing that you can do when you're trying to decide whether or not to integrate with the plugin is to make sure that there's an actual problem, there's a reason to do so. And I know that sounds very counterintuitive or simple on the surface, but I don't know about you guys, I've spent an inordinate amount of time trying to get a plugin to do exactly what I want, changing settings, reading through all the documentation or any blog articles anyone's written about it, just trying to tweak little things here and there to get it to do exactly what I need to do. But unfortunately, in that process, I've essentially created my own set of problems. I'm now so deep in different settings for WooCommerce that I can't see the forest through the trees. And I just know that this is not working the way I want it to, and I will spend a god-awful amount of time trying to figure out how to get that to work, and sometimes it's literally my fault. There is nothing wrong with the plugin. It is working exactly as expected, and I've just managed to click the right things or have the right other plugins installed that just mess the whole thing up. So, like I said, make sure that the behavior is not self-inflicted. That is such an important step. I can't tell you how many times I've even gone through to support other people's problems and found out that it's just that. They've created a problem themselves and are trying to write code to fix something that's not even broken. Also, is this actually behavior that's happening that really is going to affect the project? Or is it just affecting you because as the person building the project, you're having to do the same thing 20, 30 times every time you're on the screen, and this little behavior is just frustrating you or not working the way you want it to work, but it's still getting the data in. It's still showing what you want it to show, but maybe there's a little bit here or there that you just didn't want, that like you don't expect, or it's not part of your original design. But that really comes down to a very big point. How long are you going to spend working on this integration or trying to fix this problem that's really just affecting you, the developer? I mean, the client probably doesn't care. And then on top of that, are you pushing the launch date of this project because you're trying to fix something that's only bothering you? If the client's never going to see it again, I'm pretty certain they're not going to want to keep paying for it. And then finally, can you just hide it? I mean, I know we all want to do things the right way. There's the WordPress way for everything. But sometimes, a little bit of CSS with display none goes a long way. It's out of sight, it's out of mind, you move on to the next thing because you don't need blockers on your project that aren't real. Or aren't really blockers, at least. I mean, don't get me wrong, things that annoy you, even on the development side, they're very real. And if you're having to do that same screen every week for the next month, you might want to actually take the time to fix it because that is going to be a cost benefit there. But if you're just doing it one time, you're launching it, and you're never going to see the project again, then just hide it, make it go away, and come back to it later if the client needs you to. Because again, it's all about giving them the product that they want and getting it launched on time. Don't create hurdles for no reason whatsoever. So you've finally gone through all that, and you finally realize that, okay, I need to extend this plugin. I have to make WooCommerce do this, whatever this is. Maybe you want to show MSRP or something like that on the price. They can be very simple little things that are front end only, or it could be major back end changes, like saving all your data in an index table so it loads faster. Whatever the reason is, you decided that this has to be fixed with some code. Just remember, you're now playing not just in the WordPress world, and you have to do things the WordPress way, but you're not playing in the backyard of WooCommerce or GravityForms or whatever plugin that you're trying to extend. And that means that they could change the rules on you at any time. So before you make that decision, you start writing code, make sure that the plugin you're extending is the right plugin. Is it regularly maintained? If it's not getting updates at all, and that this plugin has some major functionality behind it, you can be pretty sure that you're hitching your wagon to a dead horse. You do not want to be extending a plugin that has security vulnerabilities, that's never going to see an update, that's not going to work when, you know, core updates to 4.9. You want plugins that people are actively testing and working on. At the same time, you want plugins that are being actively tested and worked on, but not throwing caution to the wind when it comes to backwards compatibility. There are some major plugins out there that we build our entire development environment around. All of our projects use these plugins, but for some reason, every time there's a major core update to that plugin, it just doesn't respect backwards compatibility. Half the sites that use it break, or just wait until somebody's written a solution before they update even, because they know that that update's gonna break their sites. So if you're going to extend somebody else's plugin, make sure that what you're extending is a good option, because there are some plugins out there that just, they don't care who's hitched to their wagon. They really, it does not affect them. They've got a product to sell, and that's their focus. And then finally, the code that you write to extend, make sure it's legible. The purpose of this talk is so that way 4 years from now, you can go look at that plugin you extended for some client, and you'll scratch your head and go, I don't know how this worked, but at least it's still working. I recently came into this. I opened up some code I wrote in 2012. It was trucking along. I was impressed it was working, but I didn't document a thing. It took me 2 days easily to turn around and figure out why I did what I did and why it's still working for that matter. So maintainable code. Right now, you're at a certain level of development. Next year, 4 years from now, you're not going to remember where your mindset was, so make sure to document it, write it down. You're already doing a fairly complex thing by extending somebody else's work. Do yourself a favor, or any developer that comes afterwards, and take some notes. Make sure that you can understand why you've done this. So, you've made those decisions. That's it. End of the talk. Read the documentation. But really, read the documentation. I come up with random ideas while I'm talking to people all the time, and I'm sure most of us do. We're just like, hey, I gotta mention this. Same thing happens to those developers or those support people when they're writing documentation. They're just writing away, they're defining hooks, telling you what is going to allow you to change the price on WooCommerce, you know, add that MSRP. They've got this great documentation there, but all of a sudden they realize, oh wait, if you happen to do this, and I happen to have a GitHub link where you can go get the code, then it'll solve all your problems. Well, you won't find that unless you've gone and read the documentation. It seems like such a simple thing, like, why haven't you read the instructions? There is gold in the instructions. It's definitely treasure laden. So you've read the docs, you're gonna make a change, you need to find where to start. And we're gonna jump right in with front-end work. Front-end is a little bit easier to figure out where to start at. I say that loosely. The most important thing you can do is open up the source code for whatever page you're trying to affect and look for a class or an ID, something unique to the area you want to affect. And if at all possible, try to avoid classes or IDs with hyphens or underscores in them, because that likely means they're concatenated. They've got two strings, two words stuck together, and the code is providing the hyphen or the underscore. If that's the case, it becomes a little harder to search for, but sometimes you have no choice. If that's the case and you search for the whole word with the hyphen or the underscore and it's not showing up in your code, then just search for half the word. But once you find that unique string that you can search the code base, that plugin for, that'll get you at least the right file where you can see what's calling that bit of code, what's calling that HTML. Is there a hook there? Is it a function that you can override? Is it coming from a template file that you can override? Are you gonna need to throw a little bit of JavaScript at it to override it? You really won't know until you find the file that's creating the code that you want to change. Now, if you're working on the back end, go back and read the docs, because that's the best bet you're going to get is in the documentation as to how to do what you want. More than likely, the idea that you have isn't that unique. I mean, I'm not trying to be insulting to anybody, but I must come up with new ideas every day, and you know, somebody's already documented how to do it, so clearly it wasn't that new. And there's a good chance that since it's not an edge case, the developer or the support people for that plugin have already taken the time to write up exactly what you want. Now, that doesn't always work. So you start doing the same things that you did for the front end. You go back, you look in the code base for unique strings, what's drawing, bringing up this file, you're still not finding anything. So a really easy solution, search the entire folder in every major IDE, whether it's PHP Storm or Sublime Text, or even Visual Studios for that matter, if there's any Microsoft people in here. You can search all of the files and folders in that plugin base for apply filters or do action. Apply filters is the, in almost every major scenario, apply filters is the function being called to register a new filter for that plugin inside of WordPress. Do action is the same thing for registering a hook, an action hook. If you search for all of those, you'll find every possible hook and filter that is in that plugin, and you can at least have a good place to start at. If you're still not getting anywhere, there's too many, possibly there is no, you know exactly what file it is and there's no hooks there for you to jump into, then start finding out where that file, where that function that's calling what you need to change is coming from. If that function doesn't have a return, it doesn't have an echo, it's going somewhere else, then dive a little deeper. In a Sublime Text or PHP Storm or Visual Studios, you can control click, or I believe it's shift click in another one, the names of the functions, and it'll literally take you back to where that function was defined at. If you are already at the definition of the function and you shift click it or control click it, it'll give you, the IDE will give you a list of every place that function is being used. So you dig a little further back. And you keep digging back until you get to that first initialization if necessary, so that you know why that function is doing what it's doing and where it's starting from. Now you might not have a better idea of how to get past it at that point, but if you're this deep into trying to solve a back-end problem, you're not going to figure it out by just glancing it over. You're probably going to have to keep digging further and further back. And the last point I make here is using Xdebug, breakpoints, and step through. If you're not familiar with what that is, there's a series of talks on WordPress.tv. There's guides, I think deliciousbrains.com has a great guide on how to set up breakpoints with PHP Storm. These are one of the greatest tools I've found for development. By learning how to set up Xdebug and you just set a breakpoint and say that same function that you're trying to figure out why it's doing what it's doing, what is this variable it's passing in? You need to know all the data that's in it if you want to start to affect it. You put a little red dot next to that line of code, and all of a sudden when you rerun it again, it stops right there, and it gives you the opportunity to look at every variable, every global, everything that's happening across the application at that point in time. And you can determine what that data is and why it's doing what it's doing. And then that takes you to step through. Once you've created those breakpoints, you can actually click a little arrow forward to step into the next function, You don't have to have a breakpoint for every single line you want to see what's happening. A breakpoint can just be the starting point of your debugging. So a lot of times, if I'm just totally lost on a major code base and I want to know how we get from the very first WooCommerce file to that checkout or the cart.php page, I'll go ahead and I'll load up the cart page in a browser, I'll be ready to. Set a breakpoint at the initialization on the very first WooCommerce file, that's WooCommerce.php, and I will just step through every single function from the initialization to that cart.php page until I understand exactly what's happening. It's tedious, it can take all day at times, but if you're going to be basing a 6 months project on understanding the ins and outs of WooCommerce and extending it, maybe spending a day of following every single function from point A to point B is not the worst thing to do. And plus, it's only as slow as you can click. So if you can click really fast, then you probably learn it pretty quickly. So you're diving in, you're starting to make your extensions. Hooks, that is the way to go. Every other way that I will talk about here is if you have to scenario. Hooks are, as I said, they're magical. They really are. They just allow you to do things in WordPress that otherwise you could not do while having the same benefits of being event-driven, being able to completely override complex code. I have used the hook system to replicate all data coming through Gravity Forms and sending it off to a third-party system. And I did that at any point, and it did all sorts of interesting things, like it created a combined the merge codes, it did calculations, and it was able to do all these things just through a hook system. I did not have to touch the core code in any way. You don't have to modify any of the source data. And even better, they are backwards compatible. If all of a sudden I've got a plugin that's calling for a hook that doesn't exist, that or I'm asking for apply filter or do action and nobody ever hooks into it, WordPress doesn't care. The plugin doesn't care, assuming that it's not relying on somebody hooking into it. And vice versa, if you all of a sudden get rid of a hook, if you deprecate a hook, the only people that are going to be affected are people who are riding on that hook. But otherwise, it's just if your functions.php file is saying add filter the title, and you've got your function that changes the title into uppercase, and all of a sudden for some reason WordPress decided to change the name of the filter to the title, your code's not going to break. Yeah, the titles aren't going to be uppercase anymore, but you're not going to get a white screen of death or errors and warnings all over your page. It's just going to keep on trucking because hooks are backwards compatible. They're there, great. If they're not there, no big deal. And going back to the event-driven portion on the top, this is one of the best parts about the hook system. You can allow all these plugins to run all of their hooks, run all of their filters, and then you can change the priority to something later than when they're running it and just hook in afterwards. So if I want to allow WordPress and every plugin that possibly exists to affect the title using the title filter, I can just run another function on the title with a priority of 9 million if I wanted to. Whatever the PHP max integer is, I can put that there, and it will run at the absolute end. Now, the only caveat is that for some reason somebody's working outside of the standard functions and they're just adding hooks directly to the global variable, you could find yourself with problems. That's very rare. It's usually database-specific MU plugins that will do that because they're the ones who will need to, because maybe WordPress isn't loaded yet when it needs to hook into something. But generally speaking, you're not going to come across that. You're going to just be able to use add filter, add action, remove filter, remove action. If you're really confused as to why something's behaving a specific way, I believe there's actually a remove all action function, so you could literally remove all filters and actions that are affecting the title and just see what WordPress would put out by default if for some reason it's just acting so weirdly. So all that said, hooks are the way to go. They are the WordPress way to do any kind of extension, and you're very rarely going to run into major complications. The priority system is the hardest thing to get your mind around, and really that doesn't start to affect you until you're doing some pretty deep integrations where you have to be firing at the exact same time that some other hook is firing. Another fun caveat is you cannot add filter or add action to a hook that has not been added yet. So that's where priority also comes in. Make sure that you're not trying to add a filter to something that just hasn't been registered. So if you add a filter and it's not working and you know for a fact it should be, that's probably your case. You're firing it off too early. Hook it into something a little bit later. Maybe you're hooking into the init function, the initialization function for WordPress, and you need to be looking into plugins loaded or something like that. And there's a great page, which is on my reference at the end, and it is the WordPress action hook or filter hook references. If you just Google those, you will get a list of every action and filter, generally speaking, that runs, and in the order that it typically runs from when you first load up WordPress's homepage for your site or something like that. So the next way of extending is pluggable functions and overriding templates. Pluggable functions are pretty handy. They've existed since 1.5, I believe. So they're fairly old, but you still want to avoid them whenever possible. It's a WordPress way of doing things, and overriding template files is also pretty standard. You see that in WooCommerce a lot. If you want to affect all of these different template pages from WooCommerce, you just create a folder called WooCommerce and copy and paste the new pages right into your theme, and voila, you can start changing it. But there are dangers with doing things like that. So we'll start with pluggable functions. I think most people who are developers have seen this before, if function exists. Again, it can be really handy, especially if there are no hooks that allow you to do what you want to do. The function does something extraordinarily different from the way that you want it to be handled. If you can override it by doing this, then you're set. You move on. But you can only do this once. If you have multiple plugins that are trying to do if function exists, and fortunately, let's pretend all of those plugins took the time to wrap all of their functions in if function exists, you're still ultimately going to find yourself with whichever the last one is is going to be, or excuse me, whatever the first one is that's registered is going to be the functionality that takes control. None of the other versions are going to matter in any way. And then on top of that, it only works as long as the pluggable function exists. So if, in our example, some function, if that function all of a sudden stopped, just didn't happen anymore, no matter where you're calling it, where you're overriding it, it's either going to error or you're not going to see it. I mean, it's a lot of work for nothing in the end. So you're now playing in someone's backyard, but you're only playing with one particular piece of their backyard. And that's a lot of responsibility to put on just that one file. Whereas if you're using a hook system and you're not using, or rather not a pluggable function, then you have a lot more flexibility. Same thing really goes for the pluggable template files. And you see this all the time, if you've ever downloaded a theme from ThemeForest that has WooCommerce listed as one of its features, you'll see that error message on or notice on top that says that your theme files may not be up to date with the current WooCommerce installation. That's because WooCommerce has to change how those template files work from time to time. I mean, it just makes sense. If you're going to add new functionality, you need to have a way of that new functionality to work. And so you change those template files. If you're running with old template files in your theme, and you're just or your plugin, you're just overriding them, then you're not getting any of the benefits from those old template files or from the new ones. You're still stuck on the old code. Also, multiple implementations become very problematic. Overriding template files relies on a lot of detection that the pluggable functions already have built in. And so you can end up with some complications if you have two plugins trying to override template files and your theme is trying to override template files. You can get some very weird results. So typically speaking, if you have WooCommerce is a great example of this because you can override almost any template file in WooCommerce, if not every template file. But at that same time, almost every single one of those files has a dozen hooks in them. So you don't need to. You could just use the hooks to change the display and the data, in which case you never mess with the template files at all. They're safe and secure. As they get updated, you have new functionality at your fingertips to take advantage of. And then finally, modifying return content, the non-JavaScript version. This happens pretty often. I think I can't tell you how many times I actually have to go and just override some HTML that's being outputted by a function. Sometimes, very well-known plugins just, that don't think that, you might need to affect the class or the HTML or something like that. And there's a hook that controls all of the HTML, but it doesn't control just the class. Well, the obvious situation there is that I'm just going to use string replace or some PHP version of a string function to search and replace or find whatever I want to change and just change it. Don't do that. PHP string functions are expecting strings, and they're expecting the same sets of patterns every single time. A browser, on the other hand, is very, very lenient. I can write some awful, malformed HTML code and load it up in Chrome, and Chrome is still going to bend over backwards to try to make that work. Your PHP application is not going to be so nice. So if you're trying to override return content that's HTML, use the DOM document class. This is a very touchy class to wrap your brain around. Even the most advanced developers I've seen scratch their head for a while going, why am I getting a warning here? This doesn't make sense. But as long as you've got a little bit of stick-to-itiveness, you can work that out. You can fix the warning message. Sometimes you have no choice but to suppress it. It's not usual, but it can happen. But the DOM document class is meant specifically to alter nodes on HTML. It will handle oddities in malformed HTML very well because it's looking for those nodes. It's not looking for a word that says div. It's looking for a node that it knows programmatically is in fact a div. And it's pulling out all the properties of that and listing all the classes. You're not having to search for class equals open quote sign and then replace that with something else, including your new class. Because what happens if there's a space between that equal and that quote? What if they use a single quote? What all the different reasons? What if the HTML encoding just goes wrong for that application and now it's putting umlauts in there? You're not going to have the results you want in any way, shape, or form. Whereas if you use the DOM document class, there's a pretty high chance of success that it's going to do what you want. Again, you'll just kind of have to work around some of the warnings that it might give you, because it is set to work specifically with whole files or whole pages. So it will, if you're not setting it up quite right, it'll look for the head or the closing body tag or something like that. So you just need to know about these weird oddities that come with the DOM document class. But it is ultimately the way to go. If you have no choice but to modify that HTML content, that's going to be the way to do it. And then last but not least, of course, if you guys are comfortable with JavaScript, throwing a little bit of JavaScript tends to do that pretty easily also, returning that modified content. The difference there, of course, is you're changing it after the fact. So you could see browsers jumping, or if there's JavaScript connected to those plugins that anticipate specific classes or IDs or something that you might have changed, then you're going to run into other problems there. So ultimately, the way that you can have that plugin that you built that lasts 4 years down the road is that you know that the plugin you're building on is solid, and you're only really using the WordPress hook system. I've done the overriding return content for different SaaS-based plugins, and it was completely within the confines of what you're allowed to do with the content being returned, but it just didn't have the HTML structure that the client wanted. And so I had written this combination of scanning the files and some JavaScript to override it and do what it wanted, and every 3 to 6 months I had to completely rewrite that plugin. And it did not matter how careful I was to detect everything. It's just, it had to be done. Every few months, you had to rewrite it because they were going to change some major element that was just going to throw off the overriding. So ultimately, the hook system just allows things to work. And the only time you really face it breaking is if the main plugin that you're extending has decided to change the way that hook performs. And then, if all else fails, write a patch. This is very helpful. I mean, I don't know if anybody here has not or has written a patch yet. If you're using PHP Storm or Sublime Text or any of the major IDEs, it's as simple as just changing the code where you think it needs to be changed and going into, I believe, File is usually the option. I'm a PC user, so it's a little hard to tell you Mac people. But you can literally just say create diff or save change as patch, and it'll go ahead and create a patch file that you can then email on to the developer of the plugin. Now, I say to go ahead, if all else fails, write a patch. Do that patch first if you can. If it's not going to take you, you know, weeks upon weeks to do, if it's going to take you a couple of hours to throw together and you're trying to fix a bug or you're trying to change some behavior that is innocuous and nobody's going to mind, I mean, even if it's an edge case, even if what you're doing is only going to be used by one person that ever downloads this plugin, well, that hook doesn't affect the developer. If you've already written the patch and it's not going to change their code in any way other than giving you a hook, then there's no problem there. It's not going to affect them in any way. They're not going to have any overhead to worry about maintaining this extension or anything like that. It's just there. So the best thing you can do is just write the patch for them, be really polite, explain to them if it's an edge case or that it's not an edge case, why this is important information to have in there or important piece of code to change. You know, be clear as to why you're changing this code or why you're submitting this patch, and try to offer to fix anything you can. I say this about communities all the time, and I mean this also when you're building for other developers. Try to leave it better when you leave than when you came in. I learned that in Boy Scouts, and you'll be surprised how easy that and how well that works in all situations. If you come in and you say, hey, look, I found this bug. Here's a patch that fixes it. Meanwhile, could you also throw this hook in there that will make my life significantly easier? They're really going to be likely to do it because you just saved them some time. Most of these people who write these plugins are single-person teams or only have a few people that they work with. And every time a developer who is perfectly capable of fixing a bug asks them for support, which is totally legitimate. You guys are, if you're finding yourself knee-deep in a problem, ask for support. It's always helpful. But if you can fix it for them, they're going to be so grateful because they won't have all of this time to go back and test and try again, try to recreate it. They know that it's already working. It's already moving forward. And with that said, I actually have included a couple of examples of requests that I've made. I'll go ahead and read them real quick, actually. This is a further email. The other reason I was reaching out to you was in regards to submitting patches. I realize it is likely an edge case, but I am hopeful that you might be willing to consider implementing the attach patch. It simply adds the ability to add custom fields or content to the bottom of the Get Image tab output. I have tested it, and I have written further unit tests for it. The patch appears to work as expected. Furthermore, I am familiar with your code base, and I am happy to help with any other bugs or roadmap features as I continue to work with your plugin. I don't know about you guys, but when I get into a plugin that I know I'm going to use over and over and over again, I get very familiar with it, I get very comfortable with it, and I want to use it on the next project. If it fits the mold, I want to keep using these plugins over and over again, because why would anybody want to learn a new code base over again for no apparent reason? So by just offering that, of course, that he was thrilled to accept the patch. There was no question about it. He loved that I wrote the unit test for it, and I've now gotten to implement a couple of key features that weren't even on his roadmap that I was just going to be helpful for my client work. And it was just that easy to do. This next one, I actually wrote a patch for this company, but the thing that I did to try to help them is I noticed that their plugin website had the word WordPress in it. So I just pointed out to them that was technically a violation, and I explained to them, as you can see, I love their plugin, and I needed this feature to be able to have the forms load through Ajax, and here, I did it for you. I've tested it. I went through every possible step I could think of as another plugin developer to try to make their lives easier for my patch. And then furthermore, by giving them those little pieces of info that, hey, technically you're in violation, things like that, most people don't know that there are trademark policies that come with building a WordPress plugin or anything like that. So that was really helpful for him to know that he was in violation, he fixed it immediately, and somehow that note has created a relationship that now I can go back to this plugin anytime I want, and I know that it's going to work, I know it's going to do what I need, and I know that I can make changes to it if I want to, as long as I do it in the same careful manner. Because nothing, that is the goal. When you're writing a patch for somebody, just fix the bug. Just fix what you're trying to fix. If it is an extension, if it's trying to allow you to create a new feature, just include one hook in there if you can. You keep it as absolutely simple as possible. So with all that said, here are my list of resources I've put together over 10 years. And if anybody has any questions, please feel free to come up, raise your hand.
Hi, I'm Lisa, and I wanted to ask, does it make a difference for patches or recommendations or requests whether it's a premium plugin that you have purchased or a free plugin that you're using? Is there a different procedure whether you're paying for support or the support is being granted out of the graciousness of the plugin developer's heart?
So just to repeat it, since the mic came a little late, the question is whether or not there's a different procedure or process to trying to submit a patch or ask for some help on an extension, whether you're doing a free plugin from the WordPress repo or if you've got a premium one like Gravity Forms or something like that. Typically speaking, no. Gravity Forms has a whole team of developers, and if you want to kind of make sure things move a little bit further with some of these premium plugins that have a team, maybe find out the developer, if you can, that was working on this particular plugin. But other than that, I have started with Gravity Forms specifically by just going to support and saying, hey, this is something I'm looking at. Would you guys be open to it? Which then got me in contact with their developer that was working on that particular piece, and it was really that easy. I think you'll probably find more luck with premium plugins just because free plugins on the repo are free plugins on the repo. That developer might not have looked at that plugin again for months, years. So if that's the case also, if you do find a free plugin that you need to change and it's not doing what you need it to do, then look at adopting it or finding somebody who might be willing to adopt it with you. Take this from, yes, go ahead.
Is a patch a bug fix usually, or is it like an upgrade, requested upgrade?
A patch is any bit of code that is different from the code that existed. So it can be a bug fix, or it can be some new code, some extensions. Yes, ma'am, did you still have a question?
I just want to know if we go to your website there, this list will be there?
I don't remember, but I'll make sure it is within a few minutes of leaving this talk.
Excellent.
And if anybody has any questions also that, or discussions that want to continue, I'll be at the Happiness Bar after this as well. Any other questions? Well, thank you very much, and best of luck to everybody.